Hey guys, Sam Pardee here, and I'm going to be playing a little of the mono white devotion-y, aggro-y deck that Craig Wesco played to top 8 at the first US WMCQ. I think it was in Philly last weekend. It's pretty exciting. It plays a bunch of one drops, so it's, three Soldier of the Pantheon, three Kithian, and then Knight of the White Orchid is sort of the headlining two drop that is new from Magic Origins. Well, not new, but reprinted in Magic Origins that helps enable Nykthos and also can ramp you up into threats like Archangel of Tides or Wingmate Rock, and additionally Elspeth, Sun's Champion in the board. And then the deck uses all of its Nykthos mana to play and activate Master of the Unseens and do fun stuff like that. Also, big hangerback walkers are pretty possible off of Nykthos infused draws. The deck also gets to play a couple of extra value lands in Foundry of the Consoles, which is really actually a pretty sweet land. It's really good. It's not quite Mutavault in terms of power level, but it does add a substantial amount of value to the deck. So yeah, let's get to some games. All right, here we are on the draw for game one. This is a close hand, I think. If we draw a Plains in our first two draw steps, this hand is quite good. We go turn two, Master of the Unseen, turn three, Knight of the White Orchid, finding a Plains, and that sets up, sets up an Archangel of Tides, and then we have Nykthos with Archangel, which is six mana, so we can really just go nuts. So I think I'm going to keep. The downside is that we have no interactive spells if our opponent, is like Devotion or whatever, green Devotion, that is. They'll probably just run us over. But if they're doing a reactive controlling game plan, then I think our hands should be quite good. Perfect. We drew Kithian on turn one, just what we wanted to see. So now we can even, be applying some pressure, hopefully. It's obviously really bad if our opponent just like untaps and plays a Satyr Wayfinder or something. And there's our Plains. Now we can attack for two and play Mastery. Yeah, this hand is pretty decent. I think we might actually be better off playing Brimaz next turn, depending on what we draw. Just thinking about it a little more. All right, Courser is pretty decent against Kithian. Yeah, with the extra land, I think this turn we play Brimaz, then he'll play a land. We'll play Knight of the White Orchid, fetch a land. Play a land from our hand and activate Nykthos, and it uses our mana quite a bit better. So I think that's much better for us. It also is actually preferable for us if our Brimaz gets killed off, as opposed to if, something else of ours gets killed off, just because we have another Brimaz already ready to go. So you scry that to the bottom. Meaning he's not desperate for more lands. And yeah, kills off our Brimaz. That's fine. So we're still going to be able to play Knight of the White Orchid, fetch a Plains, make four Nykthos mana, Archangel of Tithes next turn, which is pretty strong. Archangel, I think, is going to be one of our key ways to fight against Elspeth here. And now we also have enough of a fighting force that Kithian can flip. Okay, a morph, probably a Den Protector. So we could attack here, flip Kithian. I think that's actually best. Like we lose our, we trade basically trade our Knight of the White Orchid for flipping this guy, and he also becomes unable to. He either can't block or can't flip Den Protector, either of which I think are fine. If he wants to flip Den Protector, he has to pay a little bit of extra mana, which I think has some value in that he won't be able to won't it'll mess up his curve a little bit more. So yeah, we might lose our knight here. Oh, he's even blocking the Kythian. Okay. So I think we just use Nykthos to make it indestructible. Okay, he's backed off of the blocking plan because he realizes that that means just losing his guy and getting no value. He's backed off of the blocking plan entirely, so that means this attack worked out really well. And now I think we want to force his courser to attack into our Brimaz next turn. Because he can Abzan Charm something, but we don't really care about that. Especially if it's if it's just Archangel of Tithes, then that's fine. Yeah, so we'll go ahead and play Brimaz. It puts us up to a lot of white devotion also. We have 8 devotion, so we can manifest twice, which is pretty nice. And yeah, you can't just slam Elspeth because of Archangel of Tides, he'll just die on the backswing. And yeah, we'll probably double block Courser if that's, you know, if he just kills Brimaz. Otherwise, yeah, we'll just block with Brimaz and that'll kill Courser by itself too. I guess we might as well block with all of the manifests as well, so he doesn't even have the option of Abzan Charming to make Courser bigger. He could also Abzan Charm Den Protector and attack Gideon with it, but that seems really bad because then he just dies on the backswing. Yes, I think he's probably going to have to use that Den Protector to block with this turn. So yeah, I'm doing this now to not give our opponent the option of Abzan Charming his Courser, basically. He does get to kill off a manifest, but we still get to keep a Brimaz token around, which is, you know, similar value. Unfortunately, he picked the manifest that was a Wingmate Rock, so that was the one we most would have liked to keep. But that's fine. We're so far ahead on board now, anyway. So it looks like he is... Oh, casting Languish. Okay. So that kind of punishes us for our play. But not really. We still have, you know, we still get to hit for 8, and then he still can't really just play Elspeth because he'll just die to the Foundry of the Consoles. Also, now we have Banishing Light, which doesn't hurt either. I think we're in pretty good shape this game. We do know he has an Abzan Charm, so he can kill Archangel of Tides if he wants. But let's see, we have 4, 5, we have 8 mana again, so we'll just double mastery end of turn. So I think just a bunch of removal spells probably won't cut it, because we're going to put at least 4 power into play here. Might as well flip up this Kythian. Oh, wait, that was really bad. I forgot we have a Gideon. Well, he has to kill our Gideon anyway, so it's probably fine. That was dumb though. It was kind of silly. But yeah, I guess he does have to kill this. So it's better. This is actually better. But he's just going to kill two of our guys before we attack anyway. All right, sweet. We got game one. So, not really sure how you're supposed to sideboard with this deck in particular. I think we kind of want to cut the sort of middle cards that are bad against Languish and Wrath, and bring in like Wingmate and Elspeth, and then some removal and the fourth mastery. So like I want to cut Anafenza, Spear of Heliod, maybe like a Brimaz. Sort of the middle cards, and bring in Glare of Heresy. I think probably another Banishing Light. It also ins also having Banishing Light insulates us from Dromoka's Command, which is nice. Maybe I'll cut the other Brimazes, and like a Soldier of the Pantheon, maybe, or maybe we don't need all these Valorous Dance now that we have Banishing Light and Glare of Heresy. Yeah, I'll try that. I don't want to be too clogged on removal. I actually kind of want to cut another stance and leave in one Brimaz or Anafenza. Yeah, I'll try leaving in one Brimaz. Actually, maybe the spear is okay because it gets our Wingmate Rocks out of Languish range. Yeah, I'll try this out. All right, here we are for game two. We're on the draw. This hand is not great, but I think it is still a keep. Our opponent also boarded up to 62 cards, which is easy to do on Modo now because if you accidentally hit submit, you're done. You're done sideboarding. We'll lead with Soldier of the Pantheon in case he plays like a Fleece Mane Lion or something like that. Also, it's the creature I'd rather have ultimate priced if that is what's happening. Was kind of hoping to draw a Knight of the White Orchid. That would be really good. Alright, no Drown in Sorrows, please. This looks like a Drown in Sorrow. No, maybe just a Courser. Sure. Courser revealing Siege Rhino, which we currently do not have an answer to either. Ooh, Mastery's always a welcome addition. Alright, now we have a decent enough sort of thing going on. We'll manifest next turn, then attack with some stuff, hopefully flip our Kythian, play Wingmate Rock. Okay, so he's gonna be at 17. Yeah, that's fine. Ooh, Nissa could be problematic. It's a threat that we can basically only deal with Banishing Light or, having a board presence when it comes into play. We'll see if our opponent keeps it on top. Yeah. Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah, we can't Valorous Dance it, we can't Glare of Heresy it, so that's kind of annoying. Ooh. I think I would rather cast Archangel of Tides than activate Mastery. It really discourages our opponent from playing Siege Rhino unless he also has an untapped land, and it makes it much more likely that our Kythian will get to flip. Yeah, so like now if he just plays the Sand Step Citadel off the top and plays Siege Rhino, we get to smash him for 7 and then play a Wingmate Rock, which seems really good. Like he could have, he could untap and well, even if he untaps and languishes or something, we still have a Wingmate Rock. Okay, he's going with the Abzan Charm route. So I think we're throwing away a Soldier of the Pantheon to enable our raid here. I think that's a trade-off I'm comfortable with. Oh, he just didn't block. Interesting. So now we have five devotion. I chose to play Nykthos this turn, in case we draw like Foundry of the Consoles next turn. Silence the Believers. That's an unusual one. Seems okay here. We know three of his cards. So we know he has a Nissa, a Rhino, and a land. So there's two unknowns, which could easily be a Wrath of some kind. That would not be, you know, astonishing. So there's the land we knew about. Yeah, so I think next turn we'll just try and flip Arkithian by attacking. He's shuffling away Silence. That's interesting. Also, I think our opponent made a pretty big mistake by playing Sandstep Citadel before playing Nissa, because now they just can't play this Windswept Heath off the top, which could be really valuable. And now I can use Gideon's other plus ability to make Wingmate Rock indestructible, which is kind of nice. I think that's what we're going to do. That way it can't be wrathed away. I guess is it better to do Wingmate or a random bird? Probably better to do Wingmate. And we have exactly enough to manifest with mastery. So our opponent can flip his Nissa, but we have the air of superiority to kill it. And he still has a Rhino that we know about in hand at this point, and a basic forest. Well, Thoughtseize won't do him a lot of good. So we'll see if he wants to plus or minus Nissa in this spot. Chose to plus for Thoughtseize. Den Protector is going to be annoying because it'll be able to kill off our Wingmate Rock for sure, even through a Gideon plus. So they're just playing Rhino plus Thoughtseize this turn. So I think, depending on what we manifest, we're very likely just killing Nissa with these flyers here. Nice. That's a good one to manifest. Ooh, that's a really good draw too. So we can flip it up for four and then still have enough to Nykthos. I think that sounds good. So I think we'll attack Nissa with two creatures and him with one. and I'd rather have Archangel of Tides live than either of my other guys. So that's the one that I'll leave back. Or that's the one that I'll send at him, because that's what I care least about, is dealing three to our opponent. And then I think we just untap a bird token here. Make that indestructible, because that incentivizes him to Abzan Charm the bird if he's going to Abzan Charm something, which I just care way less about than the Wingmate Rock or the... Well, I care slightly less about than Wingmate Rock and way less than Archangel, mostly because of the white devotion. So I think that makes the most sense to do it this way. Last turn it was playing around a sweeper. This time it seems less likely that he has a sweeper, or either way, that the impact of a sweeper is greatly diminished by the fact that we have so much devotion. It is too bad we only have 7, not 8. I didn't want to cast Banishing Light this turn. Also, I'm saving it for something like an Elspeth or an Ugin, maybe. You know, something really scary. And casting it would have meant we have to manifest on our main phase, which is a lot less appealing. So, Den Protector as expected, but he actually didn't have an untapped land to play. Which, well, we know he has a forest in his hand, but he now won't be able to get back anything relevant with Den Protector, so that seems kind of bad for him. Good for us. Manifested an Elspeth. Well, that's no good. Alright, very unlikely to cast this Wingmate Rock, because we have such a dominating board position. I'd rather just spend all of our mana on manifesting. And we'll go ahead and do the same thing, untapping this bird. So we can make 3 manifests end of turn here. Den Protector returns Abzan Charm, no big deal. So you can kill off Archangel of Tides. But we're going to have three new manifests come in when he does that. And then we still have Gideon at our ready. So if we need to attack with that, we can like Banishing Light Siege Rhino and also attack with Gideon in a turn. So we'll have 6 in the air. We'll be at 9, so we have to get through 3 damage and have 3 blockers potentially. We'll have four total manifests, the soldier and Gideon. So yeah, that does add up if we want to go all in. We don't even really have to go all in because we're so far ahead and our opponent is not really drawing anything, you know, of relevance. So I think that is also assuming that we manifest nothing good. If we manifest like an Archangel of Tides or whatever, we can just win the game very easily in the air entirely. Okay, so that smells like a Wrath of some kind, perhaps. Okay, looks like a Languish then. So I think if we block like this, we can. It doesn't change our ability to manifest. We don't have to manifest anything right now. We get to eat Den Protector, yeah, and our Gideon will survive. I think that's a good play. He's even killing Manifest over Soldier of the Pantheon. Oh, I miscounted it. Did it would have changed our ability to manifest. I still think it's correct, but so Abzan Charm takes care of Archangel of Tides. That one will float mana in response to. Languish as expected, and then we'll manifest and manifest and manifest. Now we can just deal with this Rhino, attack with Gideon and ten him. So our opponent actually couldn't have passed there. We had 7 mana floating. If he had just passed, I would have just let him pass and not manifested. So like it maybe looks like he made a mistake by casting the Languish there. But if he'd passed priority, I would have 100% just passed back because he's facing down 2 Wingmate Rocks. He's just gonna die, or a Wingmate Rock and a bird. So I think that would have been how that would have gone. So I don't think our opponent actually made a mistake in that case. But there we go. We've got the first match, and we'll be back for more.